good? Okay, lights down. Here we go, Jim, you made it. Okay, everybody, here we go. No one in the world suspects that at a moment's notice, I can become mighty Green Lantern with my amazing powering and invincible green beam. Golly, what a feeling it is. That was 1960. 10 years later, in 1970, he's getting tumped on the head by a can of beans thrown by his friend, Green Arrow, who started out the decade looking like this 10 years earlier. So how did comics go from images like this in 1960, looking upwards to science and technology, we'll put a man on the moon by the end of the decade? How did we get from images like this in 1960 to images 10 years later like this in 1970, signaling the death of the 60s, the end of the counterculture? How did we go from establishment superheroes like Superman, The Flash, and Green Lantern to counterculture super anti-heroes like Spider-Man, Green Lantern, and Doctor Strange? Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Silver Age of comic book art. And this lecture is based on my book, The Silver Age of Comic Art, that I'll be selling at my table after the show. When you open up this book, you see one of the images I just showed you in my opening presentation. That's what's called the first title page. It's based on the actual splash page of the first issue of The Atom, drawn by Gil Kane. That's his civilian identity, Ray Palmer, and there's his costume. Now, if you're watching the latest CW TV shows, you know that the Atom, as portrayed by Brandon Routh, doesn't exactly look pretty much anything like Gil Kane's original costume. But even Gil Kane's Atom was based on a 1940s superhero, the Atom, who really wasn't superpowered. I think he just had very strong strength, but he was a little guy, so he was like a mighty mite. And then part of what made the Silver Age Silver Age was the revamping of these superheroes for a new decade, for the 1960s. Now, the Atom symbol was one of the symbols of the age. Here we see an exhibition in Brussels, Belgium called the Atomium. The Atom symbol was on products. It was everywhere in the late 50s. Even in comics, we saw the Atom symbol in images like Superman, because the superheroes in the Cold War and before that were fighting the Hot War and were inextricably tied to American ideals and values. Going back to images like this that represent the golden age of superheroes, where they were tied in with the war effort. But what happened when the war ended and they didn't have that enemy to fight? All of a sudden, all the superheroes became domesticated, just like the rest of the country. And we start to see banal scenes like this. All of a sudden, Batman, instead of fighting crime in Gotham City, is fighting aliens. And then other genres begin to creep into comics in the late 40s. Westerns. And then, of course, in the end of the decade, just like film noir was making films darker, you had horror creeping in to comics. And fun titles like Plastic Man ended up looking like this. You have the EC comics of the early 50s and the horror comics back then. And all the superheroes have pretty much died out by then. But all of a sudden, in the middle of the decade, 1955 or so, and you can see what the 50s were like, represented by space, represented by speed, the car, the design. Well, somewhere in the mid-50s, somebody up at DC Comics, nobody to this day knows who it was, said, hey, remember those superheroes we used to publish in the 40s, but who died out by the 1951, like The Flash? What if we brought the superheroes back, but instead of bringing them back just as they were, let's change them. Now, we talk about nowadays retrofitting and retroconning and all these phrases, rebooting of pop culture concepts. Well, the first American pop culture concept that ever really happened that got rebooted was superhero comics kicking off the Silver Age when somebody up at DC decided to take the Flash and revamp him. Same character name, but different costume. And this is what was successful. Because they tried a couple of superheroes in the early 50s, but they failed. It was because they brought back the Flash in a new costume, in a new approach, but kept the same powers and the same name, you've got the rebirth of the superhero that we call, in retrospect, the Silver Age of comics. The Flash being the first hero, interesting now, all of the superheroes you see in TV and movies all come out of this era. And, you know, people seem to like the Flash. I think it's in its third season. We all remember the 1989 Flash. I hated that bulky, muscular costume, which was a knockoff of the Batman 1989 thing. But the Flash is still the keynote figure of the Silver Age, as you see here on the recently released Toshin book that puts that Flash image by Carmen Infantino, inked by Joe Kubert, on the cover. And like I said, the pop culture of the day was what it was all about. Speed, outer space, beating the Russians after 1957 and Sputnik. And then, of course, you always have the missiles and the idea that even these great achievements are always going to turn towards military uses. That's why the hero of the age became the test pilot, as we can see in advertisements like this, where they merge the car culture with the military culture. Well, just like in the 1940s, all the superheroes were fighting World War II, so here we were in the Cold War a decade later, and DC Comics creates a test pilot to fight the war on crime. And of course, who is that test pilot? His name is Hal Jordan. You would know him better as Green Lantern. Remember those missiles I just showed you in that car ad? Well, there they are, Menace of the Runaway Missile, 1959. And you can see how Gil Kane took the original 1940s Green Lantern, just like they took the Flash, and look at the style of costumes. In the 40s, they were based on magicians' outfits. They were baggier. Look at the type of cape was actually a cloak. But look at Gil Kane's sleek design for the 1960s, essentially, for the Cold War, for a new age. Now, we all know that Pretty Boy Ryan Reynolds was cast wrong. At least they got the costume somewhat right, although I hate the fact that it's open eye holes, because Green Arrow, like some superheroes, have the one-way white lenses like Batman, and it drives me nuts that they don't follow through with that. But he was really a super astronaut, because the astronauts were the heroes of the day. If you've seen the movie The Right Stuff, you know that the country, the government, was marketing these astronauts as superheroes. So, lo and behold, what does DC Comics come up with? Earth's first superhero, Adam Strange, also drawn by the Flash artist Carmen Infantino. And these are some classic covers with classic Infantino split cover motif designs. But you can see that the concerns of the day, the atom bomb, make their way into these comics. Look at this incredible Infantino Anderson cover and how beautifully that... But this was the fear that what everybody was living with in the late 50s during the era of the atom bomb. And that's why this image was key as the first title page of my book. Now, when you turn the page, that image is ghosted behind all the copyright type, and then you get what's called the proper title page of the book. Now, you wouldn't expect an image of Jesus Christ crucified would be the keynote image for the title page of a book called The Silver Age of Comic Book Art, and yet it is. And when you go to my introduction, I begin to explain how we get from that image on the left in 1960 to the image on the right in 1970, which in a sense is what my book is about. And it takes you through each chapter based on each artist and showing you how the 1960s were reflected politically in the comics of the time, and how through the art itself, stories became more and more realistic and reflective of what was happening in the decade. So we begin, of course, with Infantino's The Flash. And if you look at the image that's ghosted behind the type, that's basically the cornucopia of characters that Infantino worked on during his DC Comics career. He was basically the DC equivalent of Jack Kirby over at Marvel. And there, of course, is his keynote character, The Flash. Isn't incredible, only in comics would a guy named Carmine Infantino, which means red, the word Carmine, and he would be closely identified with the ultimate red-suited superhero. I mean, only in comics, right? Truth is stranger than fiction. You can see how the TV show tries in live-action computer effects to get across the feeling of motion that really nobody's ever done better than Carmen Infantino, usually inked by the great Murphy Anderson. But the strobing effect in two dimensions is still the graphic effect for any artist trying to delineate speed. Now, in my book, most of the text is the artist talking about the art. That's Infantino telling you how he designed the Flash's costume. You see the figure in the upper left corner of Captain Marvel from the 1940s? That's what Infantino was thinking about, the red and yellow, the lightning bolts. And so you read my book like a giant comic book, but it's actually an art book and a history book. This is one of the images that I just love of Infantino and the Wave. And I do a whole lecture on the relation between fine art and comic book art, because I find that image just as beautiful as this classic wave by Hokusai, the wave of Kanagawa that you've seen in every living room and whatever. The other character, of course, Infantino did the great Adam Strange, Infantino Anderson artwork, and there's the double page spread again. All the text is Infantino telling you about the art. When I interviewed Infantino way before he passed away in 2013, I said to him, you know, what I love about your figures is they're not the typical muscle-bound, steroided-out superheroes that you see everybody having today. Your figures are live, they're lean. And I said, you know, they're almost feminine for these masculine superheroes. This is one of my favorite drawings of Adam Strange ever. And Infantino said, you know, Arlen, I was influenced by the great Modigliani and his long, elongated feminine figures. Now, there's nothing long and elongated about Batman's muscular figure here, but he was also the Batman artist of the 1960s, and this is a double-page spread of the greatest hits of his covers. Right before Infantino stopped drawing full-time and became the first artist to become head of a comic book company in late 67, he did two of the greatest covers of his career, where you can really see his design sense and how he was playing. These both appeared in the summer of 1967. You know, the rest of the country was celebrating the summer of love. Well, in comics, this was the love that we got from Carmen Infantino. I love his whole California suburban modern motifs. This is just a postage stamp size panel, but it's one of my favorite panels of Infantino ever. Now, very diametrically opposed from what was happening over in Marvel Comics at the same time by this artist. This almost looks like a German expressionist painting of the city. And yet, you talk about postage stamp size, it literally is a postage stamp size last panel of the very first Spider-Man story. But when you blow it up like this, you know, you don't need Roy Lichtenstein to repaint comic book panels to make them art. You just need to take the actual panels themselves and make them big like art, and they become art. When I said this looks like a German expressionist, it reminds me of the cabinet of Dr. Caligari from 1927, one of the great German expressionist films. This, of course, is the great art by the one and only, the unique Steve Ditko, the co-creator of Spider-Man and the full creator of Doctor Strange. That obscure character on the left is The Question, for those of you who don't know. This is the intro spread for Ditko in my book, and it's all about his costume design. And that image on the left, again, is the size, maybe that's a 3-inch high panel, but by blowing it up big, I'm making an indirect statement that in comics, until the artist puts pen to paper, you don't have a creation. And this becomes more salient when we talk about the ownership of these characters, Jack Kirby. When you come to my Kirby lecture at 5 o'clock, I'll go into this more. But again, all that text in those upper balloons is Ditko talking about how he designed Spider-Man. And it's really that costume, the most unique costume in the history of comics, that is responsible for the success of Spider-Man in the movies. Now, most people don't realize that not only did Ditko design Spider-Man, but the classic red and yellow design of Iron Man is also Ditko's design, because in 1964, Iron Man was still the clunky gold metal robot that you see there on the left. But it was Ditko who drew this particular issue and designed the Spider-Man outfit, again with a full mask a la Spider-Man, so that the reader can identify with that was Ditko's philosophy of mask design. And that's why you get the Iron Man of today, which still essentially uses Ditko's design. But it was Spider-Man that is still essentially the Sean Connery of Spider-Man, if you know my analogy there. In my book, I take that classic image. Nobody to this day, people have imitated Ditko, they've been Spider-Man in all different positions, But nobody has ever gotten the combination of actual realistic anatomy, which Ditko is not normally known for, with the hyperbolic, exaggerated, spider-like anatomy of what you would call a human spider in these samples I've shown you here. And the actual design of Spider-Man is what a graphic designer would do for a corporation. For all intents and purposes, this is no different than the Mickey Mouse ears. Yeah, let this image sink in. It's like a bad acid flashback. But that is what Ditko gave Marvel Comics. Now, his other great creation, of course, was the Master of the Mystic, Doctor Strange. In my opening spread here, I show you his transformation from the washed-up American surgeon to the sort of quasi-Asian-looking Doctor Strange that Ditko gives him originally. Now, we all seem to get behind the idea that Benedict Cumberbatch actually was a pretty good Doctor Strange. I enjoyed the movie. There wasn't actually enough Ditko in it, but there was enough in it that I was happy with it. Because to me, Doctor Strange is all about the fact that if you were, you know, watching American television in 1965, you were shown images like this of a doctor and his aged mentor with Eastern mysticism and ectoplasmic mind melding. If you were watching American television in 1965, this is what you got for a doctor and his aged mentor. And that's why comics were always years ahead of the rest of the culture. Doctor Strange in particular, if you look at the examples in my book here, actually influenced all of the psychedelic San Francisco school of artists that came 3, 4, 5 years after Doctor Strange was being done by Ditko. If you look at down below there, the first Trips Festival resembles a Ditko Doctor Strange image. The very first Fillmore West rock and roll posters used Doctor Strange. Ken Kesey's Merry Pranksters went across America in 1964, dousing the country with then-legal LSD, and according to Tom Wolfe, who wrote the book The Electric Roulette Acid Test, which is the best book about the 60s ever, he'll tell you that the somewhere in all that psychedelic art were the Marvel Comics characters festooned. And Tom Wolfe actually said that Kesey was in the back of the bus reading Doctor Strange comics while they were traveling across America. Look at Ken Kesey's January 66 acid test poster, and what do you see right there in the center? But of course, that's the Jack Kirby Thor. Now, you might be used to, the younger people especially, thinking of Thor as the movie character from the first movie. Here's the second movie. But if you're a comic book fan of the Jack Kirby Thor, when you see images like this, you think, Thor without the helmet ends up looking like a hippie, man. Thor needs the helmet. That's what makes Kirby's Thor. That's why I put these images on this double page spread, to show you the evolution of the character. If you look at his first appearance, he was basically Marvel Superman. That's why you get the red, yellow, and blue primary colors. But you can see, as Kirby went on in the 60s, his art became bulkier and bigger, and you can see the way Thor even became bigger as the 60s went on. But these were the characters that came off of Jack Kirby's drawing table, the Marvel Universe as we know it today. But of all the characters, I had to choose the Thing as the keynote character in the opening portrait of my Kirby chapter. The image that's ghosted behind the type there is that self-portrait image. Of course, the Marvel Universe kicks off with the Fantastic Four in 1961, kicking off the Marvel Silver Age proper. You're aware of the movies that were made. About 10 years ago, they made one. Then in 07, maybe it was a little bit better, the Silver Surfer movie. I think we can all agree, nobody seemed to like the Fantastic Four movie that came out a year or two ago. But back to the comics, it was in the page of the Fantastic Four that Kirby, with editor and dialoguer Stan Lee, ended up creating the Marvel Universe as we know it today. The first character they bring back from the 40s is Submariner, and there is a Jack Kirby version. Of course, who does he resemble later on in the 60s? Absolutely, you can't tell me that that is not the Submariner's whole look brought to television. Then in issue 5, they debut Dr. Doom, the ultimate villain of the Marvel Universe. That's the way he looked on the first cover. The more mature Dr. Strange, Dr. Doom that you're used to, of course, later on in the 60s, Kirby at his peak. And this is an image that had to influence this obscure film villain. Maybe you've heard of him. But yes, George Lucas was a comic book fan working in a comic book store in the late 60s, and so much of Star Wars, the Force, the Jedi Knights, the relationship, the You Are My Father, all that stuff, all comes out of Kirby's comics, because Lucas was a comic book fan. And there's Dr. Doom from that cover, the annuals. This was where, 1965, only an artist like Jack Kirby could have drawn this image, basically including every character he either created or co-created on one single cover. And in my book, I take this classic image and I slightly redesign it. Remember I said I put the thing as the keynote image. That's a sketch that Kirby gave to a student, but Kirby went on record as saying that out of all the characters that he created, the one that he most identifies, that is most like him, that talks like him, moves like him, was the Thing. And that's why that image is there. Then comes the Hulk. Now, a lot of people think the Hulk comes out of the whole Jekyll and Hyde thing, but as I tried to tell the story on this double page spread, Martin Goodman, who was the publisher of Marvel, was very savvy about marketing trends. And in 1961, the biggest selling toy was the first Aurora Monster model, which, because the movies were in black and white, somebody, James Bama, the artist, they decided to paint Frankenstein green. So after the success of Fantastic Four, the Thing was the monster character, the most popular. Goodman basically says to Kirby and Lee, can you give me a superhero version of Frankenstein? Well, the reason why the center figure is gray, that's from the first issue, is that Stan Lee probably forgot the dictum that Martin Goodman wanted a superhero Frankenstein. Lee thought, according to what he said, that he thought gray would be a more spookier color for a monster. But Goodman must have flipped his lid when he saw the gray Hulk and said, what happened to my green? Where's my super Frankenstein? Which is why, starting in issue two, you get the green Hulk, and they've never looked back since then. And the Hulk, of course, has gone on to become one of Marvel's key figures, to the point where, in the latest Avengers movie, Rolling Stone featured him, out of all the superheroes, on the cover. Another character with almost as much bulk as the Hulk was that first bulky Iron Man. He starts out gray. What just happened? We got a weak connection or something? What's happening? Why are we losing?
It's here.
Okay, something just is flickering. What I wanted to say was, I lost my train of thought. Anyway, this is from the origin of Iron Man. In the first movie, they paid homage to the bulky Iron Man, if you recall. But before long, of course, we got the red and yellow Iron Man. But in a sense, it's still derived from a Kirby character. The other popular Marvel movie now, the Captain America movies, Captain America debuts in 1941 when Kirby and his partner Joe Simon were very young. There, they're working for DC Comics in 1940 on a Boy Commando strip. And then they decide, a year before America enters the war, to come up with a patriotic superhero, Captain America. They were two Jews that wanted to create something to elevate America's consciousness. If you know your history, America was very isolationist. They didn't want to fight what was called Europe's War, and they certainly weren't going to fight a war to save the Jews, if you know your history. So they decided, what can we do? They create Captain America, and Captain America's overnight success. He's really just a 20th century version of Uncle Sam. I mean, I found this image on the internet. I don't know whether it was actually created for the movie, but I like how in the first Captain America movie, they actually paid homage to this, because in real life, Captain America was so successful that they dressed up actors to act as Captain America and stump for war bonds. But just like all the other superheroes, by the end of the war, Captain America had died off. This is his second to last issue, because the horror craze from 1949, and 2 issues later, Captain America was gone. Remember I said that they tried to bring some superheroes back before The Flash in 1956? So Marvel, or as they were known back then, still is, I think, Atlas in the 1950s, they tried to bring Captain America back. That is artwork by the future Spider-Man artist Johnny Romita. But remember I said the key to Flash's success was that they didn't bring the Flash back in the same costume. The reason why this Captain America from 1955 maybe lasted only 3 issues and you can see they posed him now as a commie smasher. I remember Neil Adams telling me when I worked for him, he goes, Arlen, we were taught to believe that the communists were worse than the Nazis, and that's why Captain America's commie smasher. The success of The Flash, I think, is a tribute to the fact that there was something new about him. It was that costume, so it wasn't just taking the 1940s Flash and publishing him in 1956. But it wasn't until this incident in 1963 that so affected Jack Kirby that he felt now is the time to bring Captain America back. Because in the spring of 1964, Captain America does reemerge in the Avengers. He's so successful that by the summer of 64, he's in his own backup series behind. There's one of the few times Kirby returned to Iron Man and drawing him in the red and yellow costume. But it was Captain America that, if the Thing was the character he most identified with, it was Captain America that Kirby said he most enjoyed drawing, because, as you can see on this double-page spread, to Kirby it was all about movement and action. And I take out the original word balloons on the right-hand side, that's Kirby telling you how he designed fight scenes and choreographed them like violent ballets. So you can see, almost like pro football, there's both violence and grace and gymnastics in these incredible images. So powerful that they couldn't help but affect other artists working at other companies, like Gil Kane at DC Comics was trying in Green Lantern to get across that same power as Kirby. 2 years later, he goes to Marvel and draws Captain America and really brings the whole Kirby look full circle. Gil Kane actually worked for Kirby, and Kirby was one of his mentors when he was starting out as a young Jewish artist named Eli Katz, who also changed his name. In this double page spread, I show you what I just showed you, that path of how Kane went from Captain America. He even says here in the word balloon that he feels he never achieved that Kirby power. But by putting this incredible cover on a full page, I'm basically saying to Gil Kane, hey Gil, I think you're a little hard on yourself. I think you did pretty well. But there's Captain America, so successful when Kirby brings him back, that you can see when they went to TV in 1966, that it was Captain America that was positioned as the leader of the Marvel Universe. So successful that within 12 issues, he becomes the de facto leader of the Avengers. Well, not de facto, the real leader. And even in this image, though Robert Downey is the more popular actor, you can still see how they position Captain America to still be the leader of the Avengers. How successful have the Marvel superheroes on screen be? As Stan Lee once said, enough said. The other big characters from the Silver Age that have made an impact, of course, in Hollywood have been the X-Men. That's also a Kirby Lee creation. I never put Stan Lee's name first, and that's a whole other story that I'll get into in my Kirby lecture. But in 1963, they do the X-Men. There is their Dr. Doom Magneto, or Magneto. I've always said Magneto, but this is a part of the comic book conversation that's been going on. Submariner, Submariner, right? Anyway, you can see the movies did a pretty good job of translating Kirby's designs. When you look at this image from the first X-Men and you come in close, those of you with sharp, fine art eyes will spot Roy Lichtenstein's famous image duplicator. Lichtenstein would knock off a lot of the Marvel Comics artists, not just Kirby. You can see here what he did with a John Romita image. Comics and pop art were so connected in 1965, the peak year of pop art's original emergence, that for a couple months in mid-65, Stan Lee and Martin Goodman decided to put in their little logo box on the upper left corner the idea that comic books were pop art productions. Now, this isn't the first time Magneto from the Silver Age would be part of the wider pop culture, because in the 70s, Paul McCartney writes the song Magneto and Titanium Man. It's not actually a Jack Kirby image, that's George Tuska kind of knocking off Jack Kirby. Here's a shot from the concert tour in 74 of Paul McCartney and Wings. There's Paul and Linda in the lower right corner. There backstage is McCartney giving and Linda giving Kirby, one of his heroes, a cake in 74. The Beatles read comics. These are stills from A Hard Day's Night. He's not reading a Marvel comic, he's reading Jimmy Olsen. All the Beatles, most of the original rock and rollers, all went to art school. They were into comics. And don't worry, we didn't leave out Ringo. There's Ringo reading comics. Now, if the Beatles were reading comics, you know that meant the Monkees had to be reading comics. But back to Hard Day's Night. Help. These are outtakes, and they're, you know, the Beatles couldn't read music, but they certainly read comics. So is it possible that comics were an inspiration for some of the greatest rock and roll ever? I mean, found this on the internet. You gotta love it, where somebody actually sourced out all the DC comics that Lennon has up on his case there. But you've gotta look at Lennon McCartney in the 60s as being as influential to rock and roll as Lee and Kirby were to comics in the 60s. And it's interesting that 3 years before the Beatles came to America, the original title of the Fantastic Four, right before it went to press, was gonna be the Fabulous Four. But Martin Goodman thought the title was a little fey, and he had Stanley change it. So if Goodman hadn't butted his nose in at the 11th hour, the Fantastic Four would have been the first Fab Four. And that's a spread in my book, and I talk about that. All of the hip people in the 60s, they were reading DC Comics. They were reading Kirby's Marvel Comics. They were hipper. They were super anti-heroes. Here's the first major mainstream article about the success of Marvel Comics in January of 66, a very important week, the same week that the Beatles, the Batman TV show debuted. And then later on that year, in the fall of 66, you get the first mainstream magazine coverage of the success of Marvel Comics when Esquire magazine does this television spread, and they actually hire Jack Kirby to do the artwork. Now, there's a couple of major Kirby characters that are not on the spread because Kirby hadn't created them and published them yet. But later in 66, you get the Silver Surfer, and then you also get the Black Panther. If you come to my Jack Kirby lecture at 5 o'clock today, I'll go into more detail about those two characters. But in the interest, of course, of time, I need to try to cover a lot more in this lecture, but I'll go into that more in depth in Kirby. Later on in the 60s, you get the first Marvel black superhero after the Black Panther, not created by Kirby. It's the Falcon, drawn by Gene Colan. You can see how finally the Falcon made the translation to live-action films, whether you like this or not. I wish their costumes were just a little more superheroic, but that's a subject for a whole nother discussion. But there's the great Gene Colan, one of the few, you know, Caucasian artists that could draw a fairly convincing black man. Most white artists never drew other races, and what you get as the 60s go on, just like in the rest of the culture, other races begin to creep into television and movies. You get that in comics. And you can see Colan's approach in his keynote character of the Silver Age, Iron Man. You can sense a man, the tragedy of a man trapped in an iron mask. There is the self-portrait of Colan that I ghosted behind the type there. He also did some pretty definitive versions in the Silver Age of the Submariner as well. On this page, I take out the original word balloons, and that's Colan telling you how influenced he was. Like all the Marvel artists, they were instructed by Lee to try to get the Kirby power dynamic into their work. And Colan talks about that, how Kirby's influence made Colan's work that much more dynamic, and it is really images like this that are really responsible for the success of the red and yellow suited Iron Man. His other key Silver Age Marvel character is Daredevil. In the text here, Colan talks about how he used photographs of acrobats and gymnasts so he can get across realistic movement. I think, just like the Green Lantern movie, we're all in agreement that the first Daredevil movie kind of sucked. I don't even like the costume, but it's a lot better than the costume they gave the Netflix Daredevil. Now, I haven't watched this one. People seem to like it, but I'm telling you, they can never get the costume right. And of course, every superhero, thanks to Dark Knight, has to have a 5 o'clock shadow. Give me the clean-shaven Daredevil and the superheroes of the day. Even Doctor Strange by Gene Colan shaved, you know what I mean? And he had a mustache. Now, after Ditko's Doctor Strange, those were pretty hard shoes to fill. I think it's only Colan's Doctor Strange with his pseudo-psychedelic layouts where people thought he was actually on drugs, but in my book, I take out the original word balloons, and Colan talks about how, of course, that generation, they drank. They didn't do drugs. But people thought layouts like this were kind of psychedelic at the time. But who was Cohen trying to imitate? This other Marvel Comics artist of the late Silver Age, this guy, maybe you know him, but he was so great that he actually made you have to turn the page around and read it to get across the story he was telling. That's the great Jim Steranko, whose two key figures for Marvel in the late Silver Age were both Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., and the ghosted image behind the type, Captain America. Younger people, again, are more familiar with this doctor, Nick Fury. They're more familiar with Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., maybe from the TV show. But how did Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. happen? Well, it was the James Bond craze of the mid-60s that infected all of pop culture. How did DC Comics react to it? Typically DC Comics Silver Age, wacky Weisinger style, with stupid covers like this. But how did Marvel react to it? Well, Jack Kirby said, you know, why don't we take our World War II character, Sergeant Fury, and why don't we bring him into 1965 and make him a secret agent? And that's how you get Nick Fury, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. But about a year later, Kirby's just doing the layouts. At the time, he was drawing a few books and laying out so many other books. All of a sudden, in December of 66, we see a signature at the bottom left corner of this cover. And we're going, first of all, who is Steranko and what is a Steranko? We never saw a name like that. Well, what was Steranko? He was an artist who took the Kirby dynamic, and if it was even possible, put it on steroids and came up with the Jim Steranko style, which is basically taking a lot of Kirby and amping it up to a whole nother level. And in this double page spread, I tried to just get across in a graphic book form just the sheer intense energy and psychedelia of Steranko's imagery that to this day we're still staring at trying to figure out how he did it. Look at this panel of Nick Fury and his slick madman-like bachelor pad, and look how, you know, using a photograph as the city skyline, using a piece of op art to show how hip and, you know, relevant Nick Fury's apartment was. This was the doyen of op art, Bridget Riley, taken from the 1965 op art exhibition, the Museum of Modern Art, and you can see how that affected Steranko's work just a couple years later on possibly not only one of his greatest covers of all time, but maybe one of the greatest covers in the history of comics. This appeared in June of 1968. At the same time, psychedelic artist Peter Max was doing images like this that the rest of the culture was going gaga over, but we comic book fans were getting our psychedelia in the comics via images like that and images like this by Steranko, who himself was influenced by the great magazine and poster illustrator Bob Peake, who in his early years was doing magazine illustration like this in the early and mid-60s, big influence on Steranko, as you can see here in this double-page spread in my book, of all of his famous white background covers. And look at what he did integrating type with image in that big boom at the top of the page. Captain America was his favorite character, and that's the image I use, Ghost of Behind the Type. He only did 3 issues of Captain America in the late 60s, but amongst the aficionados, they're still considered maybe the 3 greatest issues of Captain America ever that are still influential today. You can see how the British edition of Rolling Stone took that image for its cover in 1969. This is another Rolling Stone cover in the early 1971. So it was the Marvel Comics characters that were adopted by the rest of the pop culture. Here's a double page spread from one of the newspapers, and look at the way the word comics is spelled, like the way they were spelling comics for underground comics, which were happening at the same time. Now you might ask, Arlen, where's all, you know, how can you do the 60s without underground comics or Robert Crumb? Well, that's because there's not enough time. This is a whole nother lecture. But suffice it to say that while Robert Crumb was dropping acid and still being able to do pages and layouts like this, Jim Steranko was not dropping acid and doing pages like this. So both artists were doing psychedelic layouts just for different companies and different purposes. Meanwhile, an artist at DC Comics was looking at what Steranko was doing, and he was doing his own psychedelic layouts. This artist you might know as the great Neil Adams, who ended up becoming one of the greatest comic artists of all time. his semi-photorealistic drawing style made the world of superheroes realistic and believable, like they've never been before. Being able to draw angles like this that no other comic artist ever even attempted before. Famous self-portrait from 1970. And in my book, I actually compare the effect that Steranko, who precedes Adams by just 1 or 2 years, and the effect that it had on. Look at the use of Steranko's photograph in the lower left panel of the woman on the screen, and then a year later, what Neil Adams does with the image of the woman in the background there. In my book, I compare what Neil Adams did in comic strips in the early 60s with Ben Casey trying to get a human head in the middle of the three tiers there abstractly. And then when he goes to comics a couple of years later, he does the same kind of experiment with this character named Deadman. If you squint, you can see the image on the right-hand side as the image of Deadman's head. I'll be going into more of Neil Adams if you come to my Adams lecture tomorrow at 5 o'clock. I'll be going into the greatness of these images. But I remember being 10 years old, staring at that image for hours, wondering how the hell that pink image of Deadman got in the background. When he goes to Marvel in 1969, he does the same thing for his groundbreaking series of X-Men. It is this series of X-Men in 1969 and 1970 that is the foundation for the modern X-Men that came 5 years later, that every subsequent creator has been trying to imitate or do an homage to ever since. So without the Neil Adams X-Men, you would not be getting the cinematic X-Men, because you can go back to the images that Adams did at the tail end of the Silver Age and see the effect and the impact. Look in the lower right how I try to show the comparison between Adams' sketch and the finished ink panel by his partner Tom Palmer, the inker. When I ended up doing the Neil Adams sketchbook, that's all Adams' text. And even he considers the final art to be a failure, that he didn't accomplish what he felt he had in the sketch. But that's because of his standards. There's the cover of the Neil Adams sketchbook, and there is the title page that I really wanted to be the cover, but DC Comics, I think, wanted $40,000 licensing fee from the publisher, and he didn't want to pay that, so that's why I had to design the generic cover. But, I mean, that's a thumbnail sketch, and there's the finished 1969 full-page spread. This was the Neil Adams Batman that was the antidote to this Batman that we had to suffer through for a couple of years before. It was because Neil Adams, in creating images like this at the tail end of the Silver Age, by going back in history and resuscitating the original Dark Knight, the original Bob Kane drawn Batman with these giant bat wings, but drawing them realistically, and in 1968, in one single issue, he gives us the Dark Knight that we have today. There would be no Dark Knight if it wasn't for what Neil Adams did in 1968. And again, I'll be going into that more tomorrow. But that's because of images like that. And then in 1969, a year after he revamps Batman, he revamps Green Arrow. I'll never forget staring at that cover, because no superhero had facial hair. We remember Green Arrow looking like this generic DC Comics character drawn by Mike Sikowski. Adams, though, knew his history, and he went back to the original pop culture conceptions of Green Arrow and gave us this Green Arrow that he was influenced by to create this costume, which we still see in use today in the popular Arrow TV show, which would again not be popular without Green Arrow. So by 1969, when this appeared, the rest of DC superheroes were failing. Post-Vietnam War, we didn't want to see heroic heroes, it seemed, anymore. And the DC techno heroes, as I call them, literally began to shrivel up, dry up, and die. Well, somebody at DC decided, you know what, your Green Arrow is very popular. Why don't we take the failing Green Lantern, team them up with Green Arrow, I guess because they're both green. And Neil Adams said, listen, if you're about to cancel Green Lantern, which they were, they said, give me a chance to pay my homage to Gil Kane. Let me draw this Green Lantern, Green Arrow. Because they fell. Green Arrow was his character. So in 1970, we saw this cover. And inside that issue was this groundbreaking triptych of images. Remember I showed you that Gene Colan black man? Well, this might be the first truly realistic drawing of a black man that Neil did not have photo reference for, like people thought. He drew that out of his head. But it was his photorealistic drawing style that made images like this still ring true today, because not many comic artists could pull that off like Neil Adams did. He would take, in the Green Lantern Green Arrow series, images like this from the day and draw them into the stories. His partner, the writer Denny O'Neill, was able to write stories torn from the day's headlines because he had an artist like Neil Adams who drew realistically enough to pull these images off. 1971, they do the first drug story. I mean, Neil Adams said, you've got a character named Speedy. You've got a heroin epidemic. He drew this cover on spec, pitching it to DC and saying, forget the comics code approval, you should just do this. And they did it. And it's considered legendary. Not that many artists can draw a teenager going through cold turkey. I mean, there's only a little bit of dialogue here, but it was Neil Adams' mastery of human emotion and anatomy that is able. I mean, if you're an artist, good luck trying to draw somebody biting on their hand as they're going through cold turkey. You've got to be able to know how to draw. But Neil's also a master cartoonist because he's able to also know when to get unrealistic and get psychedelic and get cartoony if the story calls for it. Covers like this that still affect me today when I look at them like they did when they first came out in 71. Neil was paying homage to his own Dead Man cover of a couple issues before, because no artist even took the time to draw realistic faces like that and as many. Then he creates the first truly black superhero, John Stewart, who they wanted to make white in 1971. And Neil Adams basically stood up and said, you've got to be insane if you think the Guardians are going to come back three times to Earth and always select a white man. Forget about the fact that you haven't chosen a woman. I go, we should make Green Lantern black, not because we're liberals, but because it makes sense. And that's why you've got the success of today's John Stewart Green Lantern, because of what Neil Adams did. And like I said, here's the Guardians in 1959, white man. 1966, white man. And by the way, Denny O'Neill wanted to name him in the script, and I'm not making this up, Leroy Washington. And Neil Adams again said, you've got to be kidding me. And that's why he's John Stewart. In this double page spread, you can see, I give you a whole history of the black superhero on the left side there, but it was Neil Adams able to draw realistically like that panel in the upper left that makes dialogue from 1971 still ring true today, if you can read that dialogue in the upper left corner. And again, look at the dialogue if you can make it out in the upper right panel here. And that's because of Neil's mastery of human emotion like no other artist, even to this day, is able to get across like that. One incredible story has Green Arrow in a solo story stumbling upon a riot, and a young black kid goes to help him. You turn the page and you get this image. What makes Neil Adams a great artist is not only the realism to make you feel that bullet entering him, but it's his cartooning skills of knowing the lines, the force lines, the energy lines, because you feel that bullet without seeing it. Another artist might have drawn this image from behind to show you the bullet entering the head, but not Neil Adams. That's why he's a great artist. After that, you get this almost silent sequence. Elliot Magan, his first published script, quotes Hemingway here, where it talks about how the world breaks gentle, innocent, kind people, and those that it does not break, it kills. It kills the very good, the very gentle, and the very brave impartially. And it's this image, the mixture of the xerography of the background. I mean, good luck trying to draw a man crying. Good luck trying to draw a man wearing a mask crying. But that is why this image became the portrait image in the chapter of my book. By the 13th issue, they decided to do their Christ analogy story based on the 1972 protests in Seattle that the SST would cause too much pollution, and they won. And that's why, since then, the SST has never flown in this country. So they decided to do a story based on that, torn from the day's headlines. Here's how I handled it in my book, The Double Page Spread. There's a thumbnail sketch of that page in real life. That's about 3 inches tall. And you can see everything in the finished drawing is in that thumbnail sketch. But you can see here, that's why I chose this image, which to me represented, coming out in 1972, the death of the counterculture, the death of the 60s dream. And that's why, in the end, the book is featured as the title page and the second title page, and it bookends my book. When you actually take the dust jacket off, this is the wraparound illustration underneath that I did on the hopes that DC and Marvel would approve it legally. They very rare that they approve a joint character illustration, and they let me sign it. Now, I based it on one of the classic Neil Adams covers from the early 70s that he did, that everybody loves, influenced Alex Ross to do all those layouts. If you come in close, there's an image of Kurt Swan's Superman. He kind of ends my book. This image is from a pinup in 1966. This image is the first comic book cover I ever saw as a child. And I saw it when I was in summer camp. Here I am about 6 years old. There it is on the floor by my feet there. The last page of my book is a one-page autobiography where I talk about the influence of the superheroes. You know, that's a postcard I sent back to my mother. I was 7 years old. You know, other kids are writing, send me candy, send me toys. I sent her a picture of Superman. I talk about how my father died when I was 4 months old, and my mother raised my brother and I herself, and the superheroes became my surrogate father figures. That's my idea of Mount Rushmore, not the Republicans' idea of putting Ronald Reagan on. I'd like to see them do this. And the lower left corner, that's me in eighth grade doing an oral report with visual aids on the lawsuit between Superman and Captain Marvel, because the assignment was just do an information oral report on anything. Well, I always tried to get comics into whatever I was doing in school. But that's what I talk about here. Anyway, the last panel back when I had a goatee was, it ends with a quote that a friend of mine said, Arlen, this quote is you. And it was by Albert Camus, the great existentialist writer. And I remember it by heart. He said, a man's work is nothing but the slow trek to rediscover through the detours of art those two or three great and simple images in whose presence his heart first opened. Thank you. I just want to say thank you very much. I just want to say this is the first of 4 lectures here I'll be doing at 5 o'clock. Later today I'll be doing Jack Kirby. Tomorrow, 5 p.m. in this room. Also, Jack Kirby's in this room. I'll be doing Neil Adams. Again, the Jack Kirby lecture, there's some overlap, but plenty of other images. I go more in depth. I also run a Facebook group called Jack Kirby and Company. Friend me and join. I run a group. Thank you for that. I run a group based on Neil Adams called the Neil Adams Almanac. It's the 50th anniversary of his entrance into the comic book field, so in my lecture tomorrow, I go into that in depth, just his first year, not even before he even does Batman. And then the next day, speaking of Batman, is the 25th anniversary of the greatest animated version of any comic character ever, when I do my take on the 25th anniversary of Batman. If you grab a card or come to my table or get my brochures, go to my website, my whole life is up there, all the work that I've done. You can click on it if you don't want to buy a copy here that I'll sign and sketch for you. You can go online, of course, and get a copy there. There's my Facebook group on the Silver Age. You know, I base these letters on the classic Marvel Mania letters, and Mark Evanier and Steve Sherman are here. They were the ones that put that together. So, So even though I give Marvel equal time, I'm really a DC child, and it took me almost 40 years to finally design my own logo based on the DC Comics logo. So I want to thank him. I'm so glad we ran a little early. We've got, what, 5 minutes for a little Q&A, or no? Any? You tell me. Good. Yes.
Thank you so much for coming today, Mr. Schumer. So passionate about your work, and it's just fantastic. A quick question. I hope the answer is yes. Are all the images, or primarily most of the images that you showed us today, contained in your book?
Most of them, absolutely. Okay. Yeah, not all of them, most of them. You know, the original proposal was for a 300-page book. My agent at the time laughed at me. She said, Arlen, nobody's going to pay for a 300-page full color. It would be too expensive. Well, anyway, the point is the hardest creative job I had on my book was editing it down from 300 pages to like 196. But that means every single page in my book counts. There is not a single wasted millimeter of space. So trust me, if you remember the Captain Marvel in the upper left corner, if one flash. Little factoid is stuck in the upper left corner of one page, imagine the wealth of information and knowledge and passion that awaits you on literally every page of my book. But thank you for that compliment. Anybody else? Yes, Jim.
If you had room in your book for one more person, would it have been Wally Wood?
You know, part of what he's saying is, how come there aren't more? Murphy Anderson stopped talking to me. I used to have a relation with him, but he resented the fact that I didn't give him a chapter. People who love John Romita, where's the John Romita? You know, again, if I had 300 pages, they all would have been represented with chapters. But I had to make, you know, it's like if you've ever been married and you had to fight over the wedding list of who gets in and who makes the A-list, and even though you have some best friends that didn't quite make the A-list, everybody before they got married has the knockdown, drag out fight with who's ever paying for the wedding. Right? You remember those days? You, right there. You, I'm talking to you. Yeah, you remember. You had the fight before the wedding of who's on the A-list. It's the same thing. So I had a criteria. The reason why Gene Colan made it in, he only had 8 pages, but he said, Arlen, those 8 pages were the best things ever done on my work. He made it in over Kurt Swan. Why? Because A, I needed to balance out the book, Marvel in DC. I needed more Marvel artists. B, Colan did 3 characters. Yes, Kurt Swan drew the whole Superman family, but in a sense, it was just Superman. Just Superman. But yes, Kurt Swan deserves a chapter. Murphy Anderson, but I couldn't do it for everybody. Murphy Anderson didn't make it in because I rationalized, well, every image in the Infantino chapter is inked by Murphy Anderson. But again, he stopped talking to me, which hurt me because I didn't give him his own chapter. So what can I tell you? You can't please everybody all the time, but I did my best. And the bottom line is, I'm still fielding questions in my group about why didn't you include this, why didn't you include that. You know, cut me some slack, you know? What can I tell you? We have limitations. Anybody else? Yes?
Are there plans for a sequel?
Yeah, what? Volume 2.
Plans for a sequel. Volume 2 or 3.
I'm waiting for a publisher to pay me to do one. God forbid, like, you know, I'm still waiting for that phone call, but that hasn't happened. But believe me, people want it, and I'm a freelance, you know, I'm a freelance artist. I just can't do it all on my own again. I've got my own projects that I'm doing for no money, you know, as self-starter projects. So that's the problem, is that I'd love to do it. I'd like to do a book in the 70s. And Kaluta and Wrightson and Jim Aparo, are you kidding me? I can do the same kind of book. But I just can't do it on my own. I got bills to pay, etc. So, you know, but believe me, if a publisher's out there and says, Arlen, I love your book, we'll pay you to do another one, I'm available for that. One more question? Yes?
Were there changes in print technology as time went along that allowed them to expand their art style?
So allowed them to expand what?
Allowed them to explore different art styles. The better use of color or...
Well, that's happened since the Silver Age. Okay. You know, you look back at those, I still like the original newsprint. I don't like the reprints. I like the newsprint coloring. But yeah, I mean, the irony is that like Neil Adams was one of the best newsprint colorists, and yet I believe he's one of the worst computer colorists. Mm-hmm. How could the same artist that had such great sense for newsprint coloring, which had to be more simpler and more designy when it's done well. Computer coloring, you have so many choices. I find Neil's computer coloring over-rendered and muddy. Yet, I praise his newsprint coloring, so it's a little disconcerting, but that's technology. It has its benefits and it has its benefits. It's a tool, and you've got to use the tool to make things better, not worse, but as you know, sometimes the opposite happens. Should we wrap it up? I think that's it. Thank you so much. Come to my table. I'll be setting books today. 5:00